People can easily find loopholes with rules-based code. So those are some of the limitations and challenges that rule-based system can have. Now, secondly, the second question says, what are ethical principles? The ethical principles, as we have discussed, are the principles that are embedded in the code of ethics, ICANN code of ethics, that the auditor is supposed to be guided by all the time. So we look at first one, which I've talked about earlier, that is integrity. The auditor is expected to always act with integrity all the time, to be honest, to say the truth, to act honesty at all times. So the auditor is not supposed to be caught in anything that is dishonest or to say anything that does not reflect their integrity. Number two, the auditor is expected to be objective. Objectivity, all right, that is of course related to independence of the auditor. The auditor is supposed to be without bias all the time, look at things objectively, such that if another person comes and review the same thing, they will come to the same conclusion. And of course, the third one is professional competence. Professional competence and due care. Professional competence and due care. Alright, the auditor is not supposed to take a job you are not competent to do. The auditor is supposed to be continually improving himself as recommended by ICANN. Remember the MCP requirements of ICANN mandatory continuing professional education. Alright, you're supposed to continue to add yourself and you're supposed to be working with due care, with carefulness. Alright, number four, the confidentiality. The auditor is supposed to work. And as you are working, you are going to be coming in contact with so many things that are highly sensitive, secretive, all right, in the auditor's, the client's business. You are not supposed to divulge all this information without authorization. You're not supposed to use this information for your own benefit, all right. Then finally, number five, professional behavior. The auditor must not do anything that can bring him or her or the institute or the profession into disrepute. Okay, always act as a gentleman, as a gentlewoman, with ethical, that is guided by ethical principles. All right, so those are the five ethical principles that an auditor is expected to be guided by. So the next question says, discuss the threats to the ethical principles and relevant safeguard. I wish to say here that this is an examiner interest, and this question could actually come out when you are writing your exam. Alright, so you need to know the threats to the principles is very, very key. Okay, first one is self-interest. Okay, the second one is self-review. The third one is advocacy. Then the fourth one is familiarity. The fifth one is intimidation. So we take the first one. What do we mean by self-interest? Self-interest is there are situations in which that could make the auditor to act in a form of self-preservation to the detriment of the profession or to the detriment of the clients. Okay, you want to safeguard yourself, you want to safeguard your interest, and that could be to the detriment of the client. For example, self-interest. For example, financial interest. If you have financial interest in the business of the client, either individually or as a firm, okay, it becomes an issue. And of course, the safeguard about that is that whichever member of the firm that is that has the financial interest should not be in the audit team. And if it is the firm that has the financial interest, either they turn down that audit engagement or they dispose of the financial interest. Okay, lowballing is also a self-interest challenge. Lowballing is when you charge low so that you could have opportunity to get the engagement. Maybe you have plenty that tendered for the job, and then you want to be able to get the job, so you want to play safe and charge a low price so that they can hire you. Then later maybe you can increase the price. But the challenge is that you get the job, because you have lowballed, you may discover that it may affect the quality of the job. All right, so the safeguard is that lowballing is not encouraged. Always charge the fee for an audit based on the amount of work to be done. Okay, what about a gift and of hospitality? Gift and hospitality could become an issue, right? The director giving the member of the audit teams, you know, expensive watches, right? Lodging them in maybe in, you know, expensive accommodation that is beyond what should be ideal. Okay, so gift is allowable so far it is insignificant, right? But when gifts are becoming significant, then you may need to turn them down as a safeguard. What about loans and guarantees? Loan and guarantee, you're not supposed to take loan from a client, all right? Unless the client is a bank or is in the business of giving loans and guarantee. Even if it's a bank, you must ensure that the terms are at market value, at normal rate, at arm's length, all right? Or else it becomes another issue. Okay, overdue fees can also create a self-interest. Okay, because it's like you are giving loan to the client. So because you are giving loan to the client, you cannot give a negative report again, because you don't want the company to go down so that you can collect your money. All right, the safeguard for that is to ensure that overdue fee does not happen, right, to especially the audit committee. All right, put pressure on the audit committee so that you will be able to get your money. Okay, so these are the issues that could create self-interest for the auditor. What about self-review? Self-review means you are reviewing yourself. Okay, for example, in compilation engagement, whereby the auditor is the one that prepared the financial statement and you are the one reviewing the financial statement, or the auditor as the client has outsourced the accounting department, so the audit firm now has sent some guys to that firm, to that company, to handle the accounting functions, and at the end of the day, the firm will still come to audit that accounting department. So it creates a self-review challenge. Or the company, the IT application that the client is using, it was the auditors that installed it for them. All right, and they are the one that will now come and review the adequacy of internal control of that application. It becomes a self-review. What are the safeguards against a self-review threat? Alright, the safeguard is that if you have a member of staff that are seconded from the audit firm to the client, they must not be part of the audit team. They are not allowed to be part of the audit team. And if at all you are involved in maybe installation, maintenance of IT, application, hardware for them, then people that are involved in the installation must be separated, must be different from the people that will perform the audit. And like we said before, even if it is the auditor that prepared the financial statement, management must accept responsibility for that financial statement. All right, they have to sign a written representation that they are taking responsibility for the financial statement. So the next threat is advocacy. What do we mean by advocacy? Advocacy is a situation whereby the client is conversing. The firm is conversing for the client in a particular area. Maybe they are championing the cause of one of the products or services of the client, or maybe they are making some predictions openly that could be in favor of the client, or maybe they are actually serving as a witness, expert witness, you know, maybe for the client in a court case, or they are negotiating for the client, maybe with the government or with tax authorities. All right, all this can put the auditor, you know, in ethical dilemma. Okay, so what are the situation? What are the safeguards for this? Number one, the auditing firm is expected to make disclosures to the audit committee, all right, about the situation in which they find themselves. That could be reviewed by independent auditors. All right, you could submit what you have done, all right, to maybe a peer audit firm or a renowned auditor with integrity and independence to look at what you have done again, so that to be sure that you have not contravened any of the auditing standards. And if on the worst case scenario, the auditor may consider resigning from the assignment. Okay, the next one is familiarity. In a situation whereby maybe the audit firm has been auditing a particular client for decades, or a partner has been in charge of the audit for a particular client for too long a time, all right, all these are familiarity issues that could cause problem. After some time, the partner or the audit manager will start to lose independence, will start to lose objectivity, okay, and it could create independence challenges. Okay, so what are the safeguards? Rotate the senior partner or senior personnel of the audit team. All right, there should be rotation of audit team members. Okay, and somebody, a senior audit staff, is not allowed to spend more than 7 years on a particular audit. After 7 years, rotate the person of the audit and allow for 2 years to cool off before that person could go back to that audit. This one will ensure that familiarity threat is minimized to an extent. So the last one is intimidation, whereby the clients can intimidate the auditor. Perhaps they can threaten them with litigation. They can say, look, we are going to sue you. They can tell them that they are not going to pay the audit fee, or they are going to reduce the audit fee. Okay, they can tell them that they will sack, that the auditor will be dismissed. Okay, so all these are threats that could affect the auditor, to intimidate the auditor to do the wrong thing. Okay, so what are the safeguards that the auditor can call upon to address intimidation threat? All right, you have to have an open channel to the audit committee. Remember, the audit committee is made up of the members, the shareholders, and the directors. So you expect a level of independence from the audit committee than the directors or of the organization. So you need to have an open channel with the audit committee to make disclosures, anything you are going through. All right. Then another safeguard is professionalism and competence. Professionalism and competence could also help the auditor against intimidation. When you know you have done the right thing, you have done your job according to best practices, it will be difficult for somebody to intimidate. So on the worst case scenario, if the intimidation is too serious, the auditor may consider resigning from the appointment. So these are the threats to independence, to the ethical principles, and we have also discussed the safeguard that could be applied to them. Now, the fourth question says, how can the auditor prevent conflict of interest in the course of auditing. Okay, conflict of interest could occur. Either you can have conflict of interest between the auditor and the client. Okay, you can have issues of conflict of interest arising. You have an auditor versus client. Okay, then you can have a client versus client. For example, if you have an auditing firm now that is auditing MTN and Glo at the same time, you know, this is going to be a very serious issue because conflict of interest could occur. You could have some auditing staff that maybe they prefer MTN to Glo, some other one prefer Glo to MTN, and before you know it, since MTN's confidential information was with the auditing firm, before you know it, they could, nothing is impossible. Secret informations, proprietary informations could actually be transferred to the competition. Alright? So these are issues that could arise when you take you're having two rivals in the same industry as a client. So what are the safeguards against that? What should the auditor do? Let's assume the auditor is the auditor of MTN first, and Glo is approaching the auditing firm that wants to be our auditor. Perhaps Glo did not know that that firm is the auditing firm for MTN. Alright? The auditing firm must be open. Let the both parties know that, look, I am the auditor of MTN, and Glo is also approaching me, want to consider taking the offer to audit Glo. So MTN leadership must know, Glo leadership must know. Alright, you must not hide anything from them. That is the first thing you need to do. Then number two, you need to compartmentalize the audit team that will audit these guys. Alright, the MTN team should be different in composition to the Glo team. Alright. And even the cabinets where they are keeping their documents should be channeled off. Should be separate. That's what they call Chinese walls. Chinese walls. Create a virtual Chinese wall between the two teams such that their working papers, their materials, everything about the teams must be physically separated. Alright, the members of the team must be physically separated, their working papers must be physically separated. This will go a long way in reducing the conflict of interest, and of course you need to bring once in a while bring in external auditors, alright, that will be able to look at what you guys are doing to give you assurance that you have not been carried away maybe by one of the clients. So what about a situation whereby the auditor's interest is conflicting with the client's interest? The general rule is that the auditor should not accept an audit engagement where the auditor's interest is going to be in conflict with the client's interest, because this is going to cause a lot of problems. But if the issue is not significant, of course, the auditor must declare the position to the those charged with governance of the client. But if it's a significant issue, of course the auditor must decline to accept such an engagement. So those are the four questions, four review questions in this particular section. I believe with all these questions we'll be able to have a very good picture of what we have done so far.